I'm in Southeast Asia with my 1913 Bradshaw's Handbook, published at the height of European imperialism. My 100-year-old guidebook will lead me on a railway adventure through archipelagos and peninsulas, dotted with hills, forests, and paddy fields. I'll tour towering megacities and magnificent mosques. I'll encounter golden Buddhas and jeweled temples and experience some of the world's most spectacular and notorious railways. As I travel through the diverse nations of this vast region, I'll learn how they asserted their independence against the British, French, and Dutch empires to become the economic tigers and dragons of today. I'm beginning a new railway escapade in Malaysia. And I start in what was known as the Straits Settlements, which my 1913 Bradshaw's guide unhesitatingly describes as Britain's most important crown colony in the Far East, including Penang, Malacca, and Singapore. And the map enclosed in my guidebook makes clear why. Britain had important trades with Australia and between India and China. Thousands of vessels a year called at the Straits ports for repair, supplies, and fuel. And from there, Britain defended her colonial interests against the Dutch in the East Indies and against the French in Indochina. I'll begin my Malaysian journey in the north at Butterworth. I'll make my way to the island of Penang before returning to the mainland to head south to the towns of Taiping and Kuala Kangsar. I'll then continue my journey to Ipoh and the cool air of the Cameron Highlands. En route, I enjoy a little flutter. Oh, that's magical. Chance my arm at the Eton of the East. And experience an exhilarating ascent. Much faster than any funicular I've ever been on. This is like something out of the fun fair. To reach the island of Penang, I depart from Butterworth, named after William Butterworth, a former British governor of the Straits Settlements. It's the gateway to Georgetown, named in honour of British King George III. Butterworth Station is absolutely modern. The railway lines are electrified. Every trace of colonialism has been washed away here. Hello. Ferry ticket to Georgetown, please. One, please. Thank you. I'm on the ferry to Penang, which Bradshaw's promises me is a beautiful island, known also as Betel Nut Island on account of its resemblance to the nut, which grows here in abundance. It's 50 miles long by 9 miles broad, divided longitudinally by a ridge of mountains. The anchorage is good, and at one time Penang held the commercial and political supremacy of the Straits Settlements. Travelling between two very English place names, Butterworth and Georgetown, I want to discover how the British first came to call the shots here. Georgetown is one of Malaysia's largest cities. and is an important economic center, a sort of Silicon Valley of the East. Its spirit of enterprise dates back to the late 18th century, when the British East India Company developed the island as a commercial port. I'm making my way to the spot where the British first made their mark. Hello, Joanne, I'm Michael.
Hello, welcome to Fort Cornwallis.
Thank you so much. At Fort Cornwallis, I'm meeting heritage expert Joanne Corr. Joanne, tell me about the very first arrival of the British in Penang.
Started with the man by the name Francis Light. He was from Suffolk, England, but he has been based in this region for years. And what he found was the location of this island is fantastic. So he wrote to British East India Company. The idea was to have a halfway stop between India and China. They want a foothold here because the Dutch are very strong in Indonesia. So by having this trading port, it was very good for them. When he approached the Sultan of Kedah to lease this island, the Sultan almost immediately agreed because at that time there were frequent attacks from the Siamese. So the Sultan felt that by having the British present, maybe there will be no more attacks.
What do you think the island looked like then?
He wrote a report back to Bengal, stated that there were 58 local inhabitants.
Just 58?
58, yes. And with his arrival, within a few months, there were about 250. Slightly over a year later, there were about 860 inhabitants. Francis Light wanted to build up this place. He personally brought in a group of Catholics from Kuala Kedah. There was also an invitation to the Chinese group from Kuala Kedah. So many groups actually settled in Penang.
With Penang leased from the Sultan, Britain had its first foothold in the region, and Georgetown quickly became a booming entrepot, trading in opium, spices, pepper, and tin. Francis Light named his official residence after his English home county, Suffolk House. It was rebuilt in the late 19th century, and for many years served as the seat of superintendents and governors of Penang. Joanne, how lovely. What sort of lifestyle do you think the British had here at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th?
I think it would be wonderful with parties, hosting dinners, dancing. Early days, they don't have much entertainment, so dancing is one of the main things.
Something that struck me, Butterworth, Georgetown. Why have these English names not been replaced with Malay names?
The interesting part about Georgetown, they are the people here. They have a lot of passion for the place, a lot of love for the history. So in the 80s, when we started to lose some of the names, we have people stepping forward to object, telling the press why we need to keep the old names. So in some cities in Malaysia, all the old names erased. But for Georgetown, we still have all the old names.
It sounds as though you have some sort of affection even for colonial history.
Well, for me, if it's not because of the British, we are not at this level today. Because of them, we have a certain standard of, in terms of education, judiciary system, you know, all put in place by the British. And we cannot actually erase history if you don't have history. It's like a human without memories.
Malaya gained its independence from the British in 1957. And in 1963, an enlarged state became Malaysia. During their rule, the British brought a familiar look of home to Penang, but they could not import a temperate climate. Around the time of my guidebook, work began on an ambitious engineering project to offer respite from the intense heat of the city, and it's now been in operation for almost a century. The town is clean, says Bradshaws, and the neighbourhood of hills renders life more pleasant to the inhabitants than it would otherwise be. The ascent is through dense forest. The British built a funicular. It passes over beautiful viaducts. At almost 2 kilometres, it's the longest funicular in Asia and passes along the steepest tunnel track in the world. Don't you just love records? Prior to its opening in 1923, the only way up was to walk or be carried in a sedan chair, a journey of several hours. Today it takes an astonishing 4.5 minutes. Much faster than any funicular I've ever been on. This is like something out of the fun fair. Whoa, look at this, look at this.
Dear visitors, the train is about to reach the upper station. Please keep
your heads away from the door, and please do not leave anything behind. A fine vantage point. Bradshaw's tells me that Flagstaff Hill rises 2,800 feet. And, on average, it's about 5 degrees centigrade cooler here. I'm therefore not surprised that the guidebook tells me that here I will find the governor's bungalow. And in the tropical forest covering these slopes, another attraction lured British visitors. The guidebook tells me that magnificent butterflies are among the objects of interest to be seen in the hills. My Bradshaws has spurred me to visit Malaysia's first butterfly sanctuary. Hello, Joseph.
Hi, Michael. Welcome to Antopia.
Wonderful to see you, and what a place. Joseph Goh is the CEO and son of the founder, David Goh. Joseph, my Bradshaws remarks that Penang is a great place for butterflies. Why would that be?
Because of the tropical forest that we have. In this region, the amount of species of butterflies is very high compared to temperate country. Penang itself has been one of the places where a lot of British collectors that come those days, you know.
The study of butterflies, or lepidopterology, was hugely popular during the 19th century and at the time of my guidebook. Collecting and cataloguing specimens became a fashionable pastime, and enthusiasts travelled to countries like Malaya in search of tropical species. How did your father become involved in this?
It all started when he was a kid, because he really likes butterfly. And he started collecting in the wild and put them into boxes.
Tell me about your childhood. Did you grow up surrounded by butterflies?
No choice. It's part of my life, you know. And when I was a kid, every time we go into the wild, he would drag us along. Me and my brother, my younger brother.
The huge butterfly house accommodates around 15,000 from up to 60 different species. And breeding is an important part of the sanctuary's work. Are there species in Malaysia today which are endangered?
There are.
Because?
Because of habitat loss. That's always the main reason that causes a species to go extinct. For the last 30 over years, we have managed to breed 120 over species. There's about 1,000 over species in Malaysia. Can you imagine? We spent 30 over years covering slightly more than 10%. So it's still a long way to go.
What is Malaysia's best known butterfly?
It has to be our Malaysian national butterfly, the Raja Brook. It's a highly protected species. It is very beautiful. It's among the biggest in Malaysia, right? Not the world, but in Malaysia.
Caterpillars are voracious eaters, consuming up to 3 times their body weight each day, and need a continuous fresh supply of leaves. Now, what do we have to do first?
First of all, you have to transfer the caterpillar to the new plant area first.
Do I just grab the caterpillar?
Very softly, very softly.
Come here, little caterpillar, who is clinging on for dear life.
Correct. Let me help you a little
bit. Yes, please.
Okay.
And you're still breathing, that's a relief. And so on a constant basis, you're investigating your leaves, looking for the larvae, bring the larvae here, and then transferring them
precisely
to the place where they will turn into butterflies.
Precisely.
Oh, wonderful. Full of food, the caterpillar begins its metamorphosis, first into a chrysalis, and then 9 to 12 days later, into a butterfly. We have some beautiful species clamoring to be released.
Yes, we do. They are ready to come out. You can help them a bit. See?
Ah,
Perfect.
Oh, that's magical.
Just in front, yes.
I knew it was worth wearing a bright colour.
They really like you, yeah?
I've come back to central Georgetown, where the city's many preserved colonial-era buildings have earned it UNESCO World Heritage status. I'm ending my day at one of the city's most historic properties. This exquisite blue mansion was built just before the time of my guidebook by a rags-to-riches Chinese entrepreneur called Chong Fat Si, an immigrant cowherd who became known as a Rockefeller of the East. And he shared this house with three of his favorite wives. At the time, Malays and the Indians that were imported by the British were pretty much third-class citizens. Chinese who made a fortune joined an elite, but were still kept at a distance by the British. These racial divisions turned into violence in the early days of Malaysia in the 1960s, and even today, they have to be handled with care. I've made my way back to the mainland, to Butterworth Station, where I'm catching a train south on Malaysia's newly upgraded railway network, with double track now in place of single track laid in the colonial era. This section takes me across the Bukit Merah Lake on an impressive viaduct. My next stop is Taiping. It's where the very first railway in Malaya was opened in 1885. It was just 8 miles long, carrying tin down to the coast at Port Weld. Tin had been mined in these parts from the early part of that century and attracted very large numbers of immigrant Chinese laborers, so stimulating the ethnic diversity of the Malay Peninsula. The name Taiping means everlasting peace, but the origins of British rule here were turbulent. Fighting between rival Chinese gangs who'd come to mine tin prompted British officials to intervene, and in 1874 they took over the government of Taiping and its mining operations. Malayan tin dominated the world market and helped to make Malaya one of the most profitable territories of the British Empire.
Hi, Michael. Good morning to you. Welcome to Taiping.
Thank you so much. What a beautiful park. I'm meeting tourism chief Dato Zuhuri Ahmed. Zuhuri, these are really beautiful gardens. What is the origin of them?
Actually, this is the most important spot in Taiping. It is a mining pool, and this place is very important in Taiping because it is where it started. This is the first mining pool we have in Taiping.
So these would have been very ugly holes.
Exactly. It's where they'd use the water pump to get to the bottom to get tin.
Yes.
And it so happened this is the best quality tin available in Malaysia.
But when the mining was finished, presumably these pools remained as a kind of ugly scar.
Exactly. The governor, Frank Sitohem, he is the governor of Malaysia, and that governor of Malaya came in and transformed this place into a town.
Whose idea was it to convert the ugly pools into beautiful lakes?
It is done by Frank Sitohem's wife. He is the one who monitor and supervise how the gardens look like.
What do you think her inspiration was?
She exactly take the idea from Lake District in UK to bring in Taiping. And all this design according to the Lake District. When the British comes here in 1874, the British are the one who administered the town in a proper way. Taiping, this is a place where we have 33 firsts in Malaysia. The first museum, the first post office, the first telegraph, the first hospital, and the first retreat for the British.
We're walking along a beautiful avenue of trees. Tell me about these trees.
This is a tree called rain tree. It's a 130 years old tree.
Why is it called a rain tree?
It calls rain tree because it collects rains. In the evening, it closes the leaves and keep the moist. And then in the morning, it drops the moist. This tree will be used by the miners. It is called 5 o'clock tree. You see the leaf, beautiful leaf here. By 5 o'clock, it will close the leaf. So the miners knows by the time that the leaf are closed, it is 5 o'clock. Stop work.
I have never seen trees like this in my life. From Taiping Railway Station, I'm catching a train southeast. It's a relatively short 20-minute journey to my next stop. I'm on my way to Kuala, Kangsarl, where the Sultan of Perak has his palace. From the Straits settlements, the British extended their colonial grip over all of Malaya by appointing residents in various sultanates. The ruler remained in place, but the resident had power in return for British protection. These became the Federated States of Malaya, shown in red on the map. Later, the British appointed advisors in the remaining territories, and these became the unfederated Malayan states, shown in yellow. Whether through residents or advisors, the British were in control. Kangsarl is the royal seat of Perak State and home to the present Sultan of Perak. With palaces and impressive mosques, it's an important and historic town where many colonial traces remain. And one in particular intrigues me. The British were skillful at importing into their colonies institutions from home. Clubhouses, cricket pitches, Anglican churches with towers and bells, and this school or college that could have been plucked from the banks of England's River Thames. Founded in 1905 and modelled on Eton College in England, the Malay College is an exclusively Malay all-boys boarding school. Principal, Mr. Anand.
Good morning, Mr. Portillo. Welcome to the Malay College, Kuala Kangsarl.
What a pleasure to be here. Thank you. Anand Baharuddin has been headmaster for 10 years. Tell me about the origins of the college. On what sort of principles was it founded? Who was intended to be educated here?
It was modelled on the British education then. The first few headmasters were British until 1965. So 65 onwards until today, Malay headmasters.
What were the boys being educated for?
Way back then, in the late 19th century, education was just to create young men to become better fishermen or better tin miners. The sultans have in mind that the Malay boys, the local boys and women should be trained to be the administrators of the country one day.
I assume it was a fee-paying school if it was based on the British model.
No, it's not fee-paying, and even until today, this is a fully funded government school.
So when the school was founded, I suppose the British had ambitions. They wanted able administrators. I suppose the Malays had ambitions. They wanted to be admitted to the administration. Was it successful for both parties?
I would like to believe so, because later on, when we strive for our independence, majority of the team that went on to England to negotiate with the British was ex-students of this school.
Of this very school?
Yes.
Now, that is very, very interesting. Today, there are 634 students at the college. My pleasure. How do you do? And I'm meeting some of the school's prefects. Gentlemen, you're at a school which began in the British colonial era. Is that a history that you're interested in, or is it one that you want to reject?
In my opinion, it's a history that we should celebrate. Not a lot of schools were established during that period. And having the tradition being carried on from that period until today is something that I value from this school.
What are you hoping to get out of your education at the Malay College?
In my opinion, this school actually trains students to become leaders of the nation.
Even if you're not good as a leader, we can contribute to other fields as well, maybe in academics, maybe in our sciences as well.
We have an orchestra to bring out the arts in the students. We have a lot of other fields that we could let the students shine out.
Gentlemen, what an enormous privilege to meet you all.
Thank you very much, Michael.
I look forward to reading about you in future and watching your exploits on television. It's not all work and no play here. I've been invited to participate in one of the college's signature sports, the game of Eton Fives. Quite an intimidating home crowd.
Michael! 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 Michael!
Eton Fives is a doubles game invented at Eton College in the 19th century. On a three-sided court that the boys improvised alongside the walls of the school. I feel sure the Eton boys would struggle to match the raucous enthusiasm of this crowd. Against a buttress modelled on the chapel of Eton College, I, a grammar school boy, have at last played Eton Fives, and I had to come all the way to Malaysia to do it. Thank you so much, Anand.
Thank you, Michael.
Next time in Malaysia, I'll tap into rubber's natural source.
So with that incision, it's made the milk begin to flow quite rapidly.
Find a British haven in the hills.
The housing styles, I mean, this could be Surrey in England.
They built the architecture that made them feel at home.
And come face to face with an epic beast.
I didn't expect anything like this.